Welcome to Adoption Now, the podcast that brings real, powerful stories of adoption to life. Whether you're here to share your journey, learn from others, or be a part of a growing community, you are in the right place. Join us as we explore the heart, challenges, and beauty of adoption. And now, here's another inspiring episode.
At the end of the day, I choose you.
Hi, welcome to Adoption Now podcast, telling your adoption story. I'm your host, April Fallon. It's season 8. Woohoo! We made it. It's here. I can't believe it. If you're new to Adoption Now, my husband and I are the adoptive parents of 4 children. We have said yes to 7 placements. So let me tell you, we have experienced the joy and challenges of adoption in the last 14 years. But we decided to tell real stories from the perspective of adoptees, birth parents, and adoptive parents. We want to know the whole story as we commit to this lifelong journey together. And we would love for you to join us. Today, we have a super special show where we're talking about the things that Adoption Now is doing in this season. And it's just been a long time waiting. And we're just so happy. So today I actually have a co-host. Jordan Moreno is the mom of 2, 1 through adoption. And we did tell her story last season. It's called Adoption in 5 Months. You can find that at adoptionnowpodcast.com. Welcome to the show, Jordan.
Thank you. I'm excited. You'll be hearing more from me. This platform was so pivotal for me. And the podcast was so pivotal for me when I was going through the journey. And as I was just starting, I'm an information seeker. And so this was so important to me. So to kind of come full circle is fantastic.
It's very exciting. Here you are. And you are going to ask me questions today. So I'm like sweating.
Mm-hmm. Yep. April's in the hot seat today.
That's right.
And you all know her. You know her name. And you probably also know your adoption story, but a lot of people probably don't know the Adoption Now story and how that came to be. So I'd like to start way back at the beginning. What inspired you? You're going on your adoption journey. What inspired you to take it the next level and commit your career to adoption and start Adoption Now?
That's a great question. I ask myself that all the time.
I'm like, and now there's no turning back.
Here we are. Well, we started adopting. I was already in media. So my dream was to really produce my own show. And I knew that like from a little kid. How far back do you want to go? When I was like 3, I knew. I'm like, I'm doing TV and I'm doing radio. This is what I'm doing. And I never veered from that path. And so I knew that I wanted to pursue writing and all those things that go along with it. And I did detour for a second. I went to Bible college.
That's an interesting detour.
Did live in Africa for 3 years. A little detour.
Side note, just one over here, one over there, and circle back around.
And then I went to broadcasting school and met Noah, and I started my career. And you have a similar background, so you know just how you start, right? You're an intern and then you work your way up. And I was very passionate about my career. And I told Noah when I married him, you know, or when we were dating, because he had to decide if he was going to marry me, I was like, I'm not going to give birth to children. Like, I just know that that's not what I'm called to. I don't even really know if I'm supposed to be a mother, but my time in Africa with all of those babies that I worked with in the orphanage changed my heart, changed my life. And I saw that I had something to offer these children, right? We were playing and nurturing and loving and all these things together. And I came home and I thought, okay, my heart is open to being a mother, but I'm definitely not going to carry a baby. And maybe he thought he could change my mind, but I mean, I was honest with him. So we got married, and a lot of people know the story, but he already had a brother and sister adopted from Cambodia and Vietnam. So adoption was in his family. And so we knew that was our path, but I was still pursuing my career. And as we started going through all of these trials and everything you go through in the adoption journey, when you say yes to 7 placements, I was talking about it nonstop. So my boss at Channel 4 was like, do you want to do your own show? Because you are talking about this all the time. And again, remember, that's what I'm setting out to do in life, right? I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know what the topic is, but that was a really exciting thing to think about. Like, here I am working in this industry that I love so much. And what if I could talk about something I'm really passionate about? And so we just did a 30-minute pilot on the radio station in Denver. And I had no idea how many people loved adoption. I had no idea that it would be national. I had no idea how many people would apply to be on the show to tell their story. I mean, it just became this big thing that was bigger than just our idea. It was really God's calling. And what helped us the most is I was so lonely. I didn't realize I wasn't around other people in the community like I am now. And so I'm talking to people, but I'm educating people that have no idea what I'm talking about. And honestly, that can get really lonely. It's great to be in that position, but when you don't have anybody that's like, I get that, or what about this, or they're helping you, you just tend to isolate. So all of the hard things that I was going through, like a baby that's detoxing from drugs in utero and all these things, really isolated me as a person. So I had my work April, right, that I was talking about. And then I had this like family part that I just felt like lonely. And when I started to tell stories and people started to join the community, that's when I'm like, I don't know what this is, but I need this. This is for me and for my life.
And I felt the same way when I first started the process. None of my friends or family really had been adopted, gone through the process, or be a part of the community. So when I started hearing other people, it's one of those, that red car theory, right? Like you see a red car, or you're going to buy a red car, and then you see red cars everywhere. Now I feel like I'm so much more aware of the way that families can come together and the way that adoption has really impacted almost everyone. But it's something that people don't necessarily talk about, especially kind of those older generations. There's a new adoption community now, and I love it.
Yes, you said it great. It's a new adoption community. We're in a new era, Jordan. There are 1.2 million families waiting for a baby. Infertility is so high. And that has changed the narrative of adoption, right? Especially in the church. Sometimes in the church, we think of doing a good thing. A family is doing a good, they have a home, they have love, they're doing a good thing. But when this is the only opportunity to become a parent, you're changing the complete narrative and, I hate to say this, but industry, and it's just huge now. I mean, last time we looked at the stats, it was a $13 billion industry. Yeah, this is a new era of adoption.
Right. If you put that and mix it with the infertility industry and combine those two, just there's so much money in it. And unfortunately, you've heard so many stories of people that take advantage of those people. Mm-hmm. And agencies, or, you know, just people that are crooked in the industry. And that is so unfortunate. So I'm really happy that you can provide this platform to just entertain people, but then also to inform families that are going through this. Hey, don't have your head in the clouds. There's good sides, there's bad sides to it. Mm-hmm. So as the podcast grew and you switched over to a podcast format instead of radio show, how did you feel as you saw those numbers grow? Because now, hats off to you, over 1 million downloads. It took you a while to get there. We're at the eighth season now. Mm-hmm. How did you feel as things were coming together?
You know, I've never really been a numbers person, even now. And you asked me that to send you the information over an email, and I just like didn't get back to you because numbers are not, I don't watch them. So many people are podcasting now, and so many people come to me and ask me that question, or they want to know how to get started. And they're like, how did you get to 200 downloads? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't even really look at it. So I have to have Noah like pull it up. And it's other people that have said, oh my gosh, these are your numbers or whatever. But I try to not focus on that because I love what I'm doing. Does that make sense? So there's so much joy if 10 people are listening, or if 1 million people are listening. I think that this is so informative, and I take it home with me and I apply it to my children. So it's hard for me to answer that because I've never really watched things. I think a funnier part of the growth of the podcast is all of my colleagues and friends who are in the media industry and who were the first ones to kind of break away from being in a studio necessarily or paying for airtime. And they started their podcasting journey and turned around and told me, you have to do this. And I was like, no, I did not go to school to be a podcaster. Like I did my work, right? I worked my way up. I'm not just going to go in my closet and like set up a microphone and no. And I remember one of my really good friends, I actually grew up with him and he's very successful. He lives in Michigan and he's like, you got to let it go. Don't buy the airtime. I'm like, I can't. So I think the bigger thing for me was really letting go of a lot of that training and watching it transform into where we are today in technology and broadcasting. And that was a hard thing for me. And so when I could actually move into the space, have more freedom, be able to talk longer than the 30 minutes, right? Because we had to crank these out and I had to shut down a lot of people. They're in the middle of crying and I'm like, well, that's a wrap.
Well,
we hit our 30 minutes. So, and now we're free to go longer. And there was so much benefit to letting that go. But that was really hard. And anyone that has been in the industry for a long time struggles with that. Like now I'm just a podcaster. Oh my gosh, is that going to be behind my name? April Fallon podcaster? And people who podcast are like, yeah, it is. It's great.
It is. My dad is the same way. Been in traditional media, radio for the last 35 years. And now here I am, kind of that second generation. I left radio and got into podcasting. Oh, and you should have seen the disappointment on his face. He's like, podcast? How do you make money in podcasts? I'm like, well, Let's look at Spotify. Let's look at these platforms. And I think he's coming around to it. But the same exact mindset of, oh my gosh, what is this? And it's scary and new. But hats off to you for making it happen and for it being such a seamless transition too. The format is perfect for this.
I love that you said that. Thank you so much. Because it was really hard. But one of the things I was really concerned with is, are families going to trust me? Mm-hmm. Are they going to share their stories if I'm just podcasting and I'm not in a radio station? Because radio station does legitify everything that you're doing, right? You're like, I did this. I'm in this space. And I was afraid that maybe they would be like, what is this? Produced in a van down by a river. And I'm going to talk to you about my infertility, you know? And I'm so grateful that people trusted and still do trust me with their stories, whether we're podcasting. And we still go to a studio, everyone. We're in a studio right now. I still have a producer. I still trust other people to do editing. But I am so grateful that people are still applying and they really come in here and go into this like very sacred space. Everybody that's been on the show has said that. And even when we were recording, you've seen it, Jordan. People who are out there telling their stories, they kind of have a canned way to tell it. It is so great. But because they have a short amount of time, they come in here and they're crying and they're like, what's happening? Because they're able to talk about the details. They're able to tell us the real truth about adoption, that this is about loss and it's hard and it's heartbreaking and it's expensive and it's exciting and it's wonderful and you see God in it. I mean, all of those things bring so much emotion to the story, and that we're able to do that outside of what I thought we needed to do is a huge blessing to me.
If you recall back over 7 seasons, what is one of those stories that just stood out to you that kind of either shook you to the core or made you cry right along with them?
Oh my goodness. I do remember crying. Anyone that talks about baby loss, I am crying with them. I'm going to cry right now because when I think about what people go through to become parents, or they waited so long and their child didn't make it through miscarriage, it's just a grief that is so hard to not cry when you have a mother's heart, right? And so when they come in here and they just tell us what they walk through, it makes the baby that God gave them so beautiful. I mean, it's just so amazing that through their grief, they kept going, they have tenacity, and they ended up bringing home a baby through adoption. I just am so wrapped up into it. Every story and everyone that has come on the show, I've loved all of our guests, all of them, I promise. Every guest says, April, you're so involved in my story. Like I am, because I can feel it. I can understand it. And I am with you as you're walking through that journey. And I love that part of podcasting. But the one story that was for me, it's hard for me to explain this. Like all of these stories are for me to help other people, and they help my family so much. But there is one story that God gave me for me, and I knew it. Mm-hmm. And the time that I pre-interviewed him, the time that we recorded, it was literally like a pin could drop. The Holy Spirit was so, so heavy talking to him, because it was like God was there, because he said, April, you've done all this work. You've produced all these things. You've made no money. You've done, you know, you really walked away from your career to do this. But this one's for you, is the Uganda story. And I had, can you even imagine? I live in this country for 3 years. These are my people. I love Uganda. I love Ugandans. I love the language. I learned everything. I ate the food. I was in the villages. I was sleeping in tents. People can't believe that about me.
No, and when I say that, hard time.
I wore kids and long skirts. I really jumped into their culture and loved them and became one of them. And they used to say, and this is kind of funny to say because it's not going to sound right, but they used to say, April has a black heart. If in the heart of who she is one of us. And I came back to the United States and grieved that, because I was starting a life, got married, and I'm now adopting, and my life here is going to keep me here. And I long to be back in that country. And so when Peter applied to be on the show, who was a Ugandan, he came to the States and he was an adoptive father. And the minute I started to speak to him in his language, it was like both of us were like, oh my gosh. And when he told his story and he's talking about being on the streets of Kampala, I knew what that was really like.
You knew
the
street.
We hear this. Yeah. We hear these stories and we're like, oh my gosh, that's so sad. But he told it in a way that it's like, it's beyond sad. It's hopeless. And the fact that you pulled it together somehow, got opportunity, and you're in the United States fostering our children.
Right.
Like, it was a beautiful connection.
You said that you take the podcast home, and this is you. April Fallon is Adoption Now. What role does your family have in it? How do they feel about it?
Well, they love it. And there have been times where I'm like, I should probably go back to media and make money if we can't figure this out and how this podcast can grow. Because here's the deal. Here's where I struggle, is that I don't want to be another person in the adoption industry taking money from people.
Amen.
So I have a really hard time in some of the stuff we're going to talk about with coaching. And I literally had to hire a business developer to come in and make me do things. And he kept saying to me, he's an adoptive dad himself. You might hear from him later in the season, but he kept saying to me, you can't keep working for free and have people help you. You can't parent. You can't parent your four kids and be here this amount of hours. You have to hire people and we have to do this. And it was really a change in my heart to say, okay, oh my gosh, this is so hard. I just don't want people to think like I'm taking their money. I don't want to be one of those people in the $13 billion industry. So that has been hard. And I have gone to the kids and to Noah and said, maybe I should go back to media. And when I say that, it's like, they are devastated. They're like, it's almost like I'm giving up on them. Because adoption is their story. And this is what we do in adoption. And we help families. And it helps them make sense of their story. And so if I just leave that behind, am I just leaving adoption behind? Like, all those questions go through their mind. And AJ's like, we're not quitters.
Oh, he's
we don't
so cute.
Do that. We don't do this, Mom. You're saying, oh, I have to go to school, do my homework. I have to, you know, turn my assignments in. What about your assignment? Your assignment is doing your job. I mean, he gave me, if you guys know AJ, wow. I mean, he gave it to me and he's like, I'm going to do my job. You're going to do your job and we're going to do this and the money will come. And honestly, when we created what we're going to talk about, there was so much peace and excitement in what we're going to do. I also think our donations went up. We're still a nonprofit, right? So we're still collecting donations, and that's been amazing and really carried us through. But that transition to what do we have to offer has been a process, but the kids have been there along the way. They are adoption now.
I love AJ's enthusiasm.
Oh my gosh.
For everything. He's along the ride.
He will tell you what's up, but in a way that's like fun.
Yeah.
What did I tell you? He goes, people are like, oh, I'm triggered. And then he's like, I hear that. And I go, I'm triggered for fun.
He's wise beyond his years.
He's hilarious.
So cute. What 14-year-old says that? But I think the thing that I am most excited for of these new offerings is the coaching. something that would have been so helpful. There's so many question marks. There's so many different ways that a family can come to adoption. There's so many choices once they get to that decision. Having that coaching would have been fantastic, especially this one-on-one with you. You have 14 years of experience in it. Tell me about the coaching.
So we've been doing this for the whole time that we have had the podcast. We have been coaching people. They call us and we roadmap their journey, basically, as much as you can. But we make those hard decisions that they don't even know they need to make before they get into the process. And so now we're just actually making it like a thing and more available to more people. And so we go session by session. We have four sessions, and this is pre-adoption. It's just in the place where you are starting your process and you're like, what? I don't even know. Who do I call?
Your head is spinning.
Yeah. And I don't even know what my options are. So we talk about international adoption. We talk about private infant adoption. We talk about foster through adoption, if you want to go through the foster care system. And then we talk about embryo adoption, and we kind of weed out all of those options. And I've had so many people think that they're going in one direction. And after we look at the pro and con list of everything, they're like, actually, I think this. So once you decide on what you're going to do, then we talk about what you have to do to get ready. So home study, what do you have to do with that? Do you have to raise money? We've got resources for fundraising. What do you have to do to prepare for this journey? And I love it because it's a safe place where people can ask questions that they're like, I don't know if this is a dumb question,
right?
But I want to ask you this, and I don't want to ask the agency because then they would think I'm dumb right away. Maybe they won't give me a baby because I'm dumb.
Yeah, I can't prepare.
You've gone down that journey too, right? Yes. You're like, I don't know. Is this a bad thing to say? Well, you can ask me and I'll tell you.
Now I guess.
You can ask me and I'll help you with, you know, the questions you should be asking. I mean, what are the questions you should be asking? And how do you prepare? And what is your agency going to say to you? There's a lot of things that you need to know, like open adoption. How do you respond when they say, will you take a child exposed to drugs? We need to talk about these things before you are deer in headlights and you're just standing there like, I don't want to sound like a jerk, but I also, do I really know how to take care of a child that's disabled? I didn't think about that. So we have four sessions together. And by the end of that, you will be prepared. You will be ready. You will know all your avenues. You will have options. And then when you get into a pickle, which you might, you can just call us and we know we can pull up your roadmap and say, okay, what happened here? Because lots of things come in, right? So we're just available to you. On the other hand, we're also doing post-placement coaching. So we are charging for the coaching. It is $1,200. It goes right back into Adoption Now. You're not paying me directly, but you are paying to expand the growth of Adoption Now. And in that $1,200, and you can also add a book. Jordan is here to do books for you as well. So if you're like at the end, you're like, oh my gosh, I want to also have a profile book. We can help you. And now we have spent four sessions with you. So we also know you. So we can help you pick the right pictures and tell your family story. Sometimes that's really overwhelming too. People are like, do I put my dog? What if the mom's allergic to dogs? What if she doesn't like dogs? You know, we'll help coach you through because who you are will make sure that you get to the right match. Everything is a match here. Everything. It's not just about the baby. It's about you being matched to the right family and situation as well. And so everything you are and bring to the table is what is going to get you the right match.
That's so perfectly said. So perfectly said. Because if you don't bring your authentic self forward, how can you anticipate the correct baby or child to come into your home and the one that is meant for your home if you're not bringing your most authentic self forward? And that might sound scary. And, you know, you've heard stories of parents that say, well, I only have an apartment. Is that going to be okay?
Right.
Is that going to put me lower on the list? You are who you are and you are meant to be that way for this child, for this baby. So I'm really excited to be able to have those hard conversations ahead of time because it's things that people don't want to think about. That's the sticky icky of what am I okay with? What am I not okay with? Having that safe place to talk about it, almost like a pre-run so that the first conversation is not with their agency where they're, I don't know, is saying this okay, is not okay. That checklist, am I okay with drug exposure? Am I okay with alcohol exposure? Am I okay? Do I want interracial? Do I want a baby that is from another country? Do I want a baby that's from here? those are hard conversations that not only do you need to talk about with your partner, but with someone else who has been through it, to say it's okay to acknowledge where you're at. It's okay if you are not able to take in XYZ child, and to know your own limitations to bring your most authentic self forward.
Right. And also how to say that to the agency, because there are certain things you can say to your agency that will put you at the bottom of the list. Mm-hmm. You want to think that no, that can't be. There are. And so I'm going to tell you what those things are, and I'm going to tell you the stance that a lot of agencies and attorneys have, and how you can go into it with a different mindset, with an open heart. And I hear that all the time. People say adoption now has changed my complete mindset and opened my heart to a birth family, to open adoption. I didn't know anything about it. And I was hearing from other people, no, you can't do that. Well, let me tell you, there's a new era. This is the new adoption, and we need to help you get prepared. You can't go to mom and dad often. You can't go to other people in the church who don't have experience. They don't understand the actual process of it. Okay, let's talk about the other one, because I'm really excited about this one too, because I think this is so important. And I would have paid so much money for this. Post-placement coaching. Okay. It's called adoption. Now what?
Get it?
Oh, there's a comma. You brought home your child and things are not going as you planned, or possibly in the journey, you got a little secondary trauma, which does happen. And you're feeling like, I feel like maybe I have like postpartum, but I didn't actually birth my baby.
Yes, 100%. I think everybody goes through that. So yes.
Well, I did it with my first one. I did it with my second one because it was so much harder. It took everything of me. It took my physical body. It took all of our finances. It took everything, every resource we had as a couple, it took. And I felt so spent. And then I brought home a second baby and I didn't have anything to give. That's how I felt. And I felt like I was going through, and I had a lady come on and talk about postpartum, but it's adoption postpartum. So it's just complete exhaustion. And sometimes it can be a confusing time. And so we have four sessions after. So you bring home your child and maybe they're not attaching, or maybe you have questions, or maybe you need resources. Maybe you need doctors. Maybe. And the story I always tell is with Lily, we didn't know what was wrong. We used to call her the bobblehead. She would run around and like bounce her head and run into walls. And I was pretty sure she needed glasses. And I took her to the doctor and she memorized those charts. At 3 and 4 years old, she memorized her chart with the good eye. She would start with that eye. So finally, I switched her and I said, you got to do the other eye first. I think she's memorizing this chart. So he did, and found that she needed glasses. Before that, we had so many people giving us advice that had no idea her situation. They had no background. People were sending us to an eye doctor that does like eye therapy. And not that that's wrong, but it was not right for us. And it was about to cost us $5,000 out of pocket. If I would have sat down with somebody who had the resources that we do at Adoption Now and been able to kind of like cross off the list, I never would have gone there. I would have seen that in talking about this, she has a brilliant memory. Yeah. Wait a second. Is she using that to contradict with the doctor? You know, so we believe that in these four sessions, we will roadmap out. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a licensed counselor. So I'm not here to do that, but all my friends are. I will send you to the right place. Everybody thinks when you bring home your child, it's the end of the journey. It's actually just the beginning. And so when you have somebody there with you that helps you, a lot of people are like, yay. They just want to look at you and go, yay. Remember that feeling? Yay, you brought home the child. The end. The church kind of pulls back their resources, not intentionally, but they think, well, like the hard part is done. No, the hard part has just started. And let me walk four sessions with you and we can get somewhere that's really, really supportive for you. Maybe you're tired. Maybe you and your husband don't see eye to eye. This is not the romantic story you thought you were going to have. It's okay. You're not the only one. I know you're in the trenches. I know it's really hard, but we're here to hand you that life rope and bring you through, and so that you have some really good concrete ideas to bring healing to your child and to you. So we are excited about offering that as well.
You talk so much about community, and now you're offering a true community through Patreon. Tell me about that.
Jordan, I'm so pumped. I love this place. People came to me a couple of years ago and said, you should do this. And I said, no, I don't want to be a part of the rat race of money and all that. And then the business developer came and said, you should do Patreon. And I said, okay. And my husband's like, are you serious? I have been saying this for so long. And he just comes in here like, that's a good idea.
It's always when it comes from someone else, right?
Right. And so we set up this page. And what I love about it is it's a way for people to, first of all, give back. A lot of people come on the show or they've gotten something from Adoption Now. And they're like, how can I like be a part of the story? How can I give back? How can I support Adoption Now? They send me wonderful messages and I love that so much. But now you can send me a message on Patreon and everybody can see how Adoption Now has benefited you and what we can do for other people, right? So this is growing our adoption community in a place where you're going to see behind the scenes, you're going to see my kids, you're going to see guests, we're going to do follow-up stories, you're going to get Adoption Now swag. It's just the Adoption Now Patreon page where we can all connect in a way that's really positive. One of the things I love about what Adoption Now has become is that we help people in a way, and I always say this word, gritty. Like we've become gritty in adoption. We've become wise in adoption. But the trick is not to have a hard heart towards adoption. And many people in their journey get that way. They learn things they didn't want to learn. They see the dark side of adoption. They see how much money it is. They see abuse. They've seen some really ugly, horrible things. And that gritty wisdom has turned to a hard heart. And then when anybody brings it up, they don't want to help. They don't even want to say you should do it. They're sometimes really negative, right? We're seeing in these groups that often they can be really negative. And what we want to do is be gritty and wise. We know the stories, but we're also loving and we go to God and we ask him to give us a heart of flesh. Please, God, make my heart soft towards adoption so that I'm not bitter and I'm not angry and so that you can use me so that I can actually make change. I can actually encourage people who are really, really struggling. And that's what I feel like Adoption Now is. And our stories kind of are like that. We go to some dark places, Jordan.
Yes.
You've heard the episodes, but then there's this like, there's a soft heart in these stories that comes through the wreckage. And that's really what Adoption Now is how can we help you stay soft to what God is saying, even though this is hard? And how can we help you emerge and be able to still be encouraging and still help other people that are drowning? And I feel like the Patreon page has brought so many of those people who are like down to earth, but also they are funny and they're loving and they're not giving up on finding the help for their children. So we answer questions. We do Q&A. We also take other people's suggestions. So if you are like, I really want to see a show on this, we do have a content influencer level that you can become part of, which is great to hear back from what you want. We want to give you what you want, what you need. And so this is the opportunity to do that. So please sign up for Patreon.
There's so much happening. There's so much to be excited about. Tell me what we can expect from season 8. Let's wrap up with that and then launch into a fantastic season. Dare I say the best yet?
Oh, what if it was? What if 8 was our golden?
It is.
Season.
I'm putting it out there.
Okay. I love it. I'm pulling it down. What you can expect is a lot of really great stories of overcoming. A lot of really great stories where people have walked through grief and come to a beautiful story. And I'm not saying that grief goes away. It doesn't go away. And I'm not saying that you're going to jump into adoption and there's no grief. There is. But the silver lining we always talk about, we also like to call it the gray line in Adoption Now, that logo, that gray part of, gosh, I cannot look this up in the Bible. It does not say in Matthew 6 what to do when your child hates you or is biting you or your birth mom, you know, changed her mind. It doesn't say that, right? But there are parts of the scripture and God is talking to us and helping us have the tenacity to go forward. And that's what this season is about. We always say tenacity. We always say that. But this season is really about people coming together that are saying, I don't want to just be on your show. I want to be adoption now. I don't know how I can do that, but I don't want to just be on the show and go on my way. I want to continue to pour in. I want to volunteer. I want to be a part. I want to grow this with you. That's what season 8 is about. It's gathering people and growing together. Like, come along for the ride with us, because guess what? Adoption, if you chose it, you're in it forever.
Yes. And that's not something that you think about right away.
All right. One of the things I want to say about season 8 that I am super excited about is there are so many people who have applied to be on the show that are coming to tell their stories that listened to the show when they had no baby. And they thought in their mind, I can't wait until I bring home my baby and I'm going to apply to be on the show. That's how long we've been doing it. Is that,
doesn't that feel good?
Oh my gosh. It's like an adoption now, baby. Like they were just thinking about starting the process. And then here they are being able to apply. And then when I talk to them, they're like, I know your whole story. I've listened to the episodes. And it's like, we know each other already.
It gives
right?
me goosebumps just I thinking about it.
So I think that that's really exciting is if you're starting, maybe you will be on the show. You give it some time. I'm going to end with this. This is how I feel. You've heard me say it season after season, but your baby is coming. If you don't give up, your baby is coming. So we want to give you the hope in the waiting.
April, thank you so much. Thank you for telling your story. I know a lot of people hadn't heard it, some had, but we get new listeners every day. So thank you for telling your story and providing this platform.
Yeah, and thanks for joining us, because you are just a ray of sunshine. Your adoption was so beautiful and so wonderful. And that's the hope that everybody has. Is it going to happen in 5 months? It might happen, because it happened for Jordan.
I love that. Thank you. What a compliment.
Yeah. So thank you for co-hosting and thank you for joining Adoption Now and helping us.
For nearly a decade, Adoption Now has shared inspiring adoption stories. Now go behind the scenes, enjoy bonus content, and connect with our adoption community. Join us on Patreon at patreon.com/adoptionnow. Or get one-on-one coaching at adoptionnowpodcast.com. If this episode moved you, don't forget to follow us on Instagram, Facebook, X, and TikTok. See you next episode.
At the end of the day, I choose you.